Good morning. It's good to see everybody today. We're in a little bit of grief over the Bills game last Sunday. I thought it was a good game, though, just not the best outcome I could have hoped for. I wanted to make you aware of a couple things just before we started this morning, and that is on February the 11th, something we call Vision Sunday. And Vision Sunday is a day where we kind of celebrate what God has done for the previous year and anticipate what he's going to be doing in this year that we're in now. And there's actually a fair amount of information that we share with our church family, just things that have happened, including some financial information. So, of course, you're all welcome to be a part of that. On that day, we will be selecting the next person who serves on our church council. And the two nominees this year are Olivia Grant and Gary Haydens. Olivia currently serves on council, and Gary Haydens has served on council in the past. And so you might be wondering, so how can I know what's the best person to vote for? And just so you know, voting is limited to members. So when you come in that day, if you are a member of the church, there'll be a place for you to sign in, to get your ballot, and to make your selection, and then to place that in a place where it will be counted later. And then that information will be shared. This is what I will say. We have two choices. One is politics and one is prayer. When we use a political option, we get political results. When we use a prayer option, we get prayer results. How many suspect that in God's house, the prayer option might be a better option? So how do you actually go about that? It's actually terrifyingly simple. And it is, you pray as to who you think God would lead you to select. And based on your own sense of peace, you cast that ballot for that person. And then we go forward with the selection process. And then the following week, we'll let you know how that turned out. Everybody got that? Okay. And by the way, I know that's Super Bowl Sunday, but it's Vision Sunday. And we're doing that before they had the Super Bowl. And there's a lot of good news to share this year. If you cannot control your anger, you will be controlled by someone who can make you angry. Let me say that again. If you cannot control your anger, you will be controlled by someone who can make you angry. And this explains some of our interactions in life, doesn't it? People who make us angry usually want us to do or say something, or to not do something or say something. But when we look at anger, this is the last Sunday in the book of Proverbs, and the book of Proverbs has some really valuable insight on this very powerful human emotion, anger. What's true is that anger has destroyed more marriages than adultery. Angry has damaged more children than sexual abuse. Anger has played a role in some of our most potent and regretful memories. And so anger is this very powerful emotion, and often when we engage in it, we wind up feeling a lot of shame and embarrassment about it. And so is there anything that Scripture has to say to help us with this? And the truth is, every one of us have given place to anger. Now maybe you think, nope, Pastor, not me. I live with angry people, but I am not one of them. We'll see. By the end of today, we'll see if you are or you're not. This is why it's important to talk about, and this passage actually comes from James, the first chapter. It says, "Dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires." Human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. When we give vent to our anger, We are unable at that point to produce the righteous life that God desires. So what kind of effect does anger have on us? That's a good thing to think about. And I think I want to identify four things today. And the first thing is this: anger can destroy your body. Like, it actually impacts you physically. There's a verse of scripture in Proverbs 14. It says, "Whoever is patient has great understanding, but one who's quick-tempered displays folly." And psychologists will tell you that anger is really a secondary emotion. There's other emotions that are primary, and anger are what we feel as a result of that. It says, a quick-tempered person displays folly. A heart that gives... A heart at peace gives life to the body, but envy rots the bones. There's the primary emotion, envy. A person is envious, so then they become angry. It rots their bones. I don't think that sounds good. I've seen a lot of prescription ads on television, and I've never seen one to promote the rotting of our bones. When we're angry, our adrenaline levels go high, our cortisol levels go high, our heart rate increases, our blood pressure increases, our breathing gets faster, we go into a fight or flight, we can get headaches, we can lose sleep, we can have digestive problems, we might even have heart disease. And maybe you're here this morning and I have all those symptoms. And it can even affect our immune system. So anger can cause a lot of problems. In fact, anger can cause more physical problems in our life than either anxiety or grief. And we all know how devastating those can be to us. A second thing that anger can do, anger can dismantle community. Anger just breaks down the bonds of things that hold us together. It says this in Proverbs 15, a hot-tempered person stirs up conflict. They just stir up conflict, but the one who is patient calms a quarrel. Humans have this capacity to take their words and sharpen them like knives and convert them into improvised explosive devices so that when we speak, things just kind of blow up everywhere we go. And the Bible says that's not good. Another thing that anger can do is it can demolish our thinking. It just disintegrates our thought process. This is what it says in Proverbs 24. Do not say, I'll do to them as they have done to me. I'll pay them back for what they did. As soon as you go down that road, now you're just reacting. By the way, they've done studies. They took a bunch of college students. And how many know, if you ever want to know anything about our culture, just get college students. And this is what they said. They put pressure-sensitive things on their chest, and they said, we want the first person to poke the second person, and then we want the second person to poke them back. And almost without exception, the poke back is always harder. Why is that? Why do we get caught up in these ways of thinking? It can demolish our thinking, and also anger can become a habit. Proverbs 19 says it this way: a hot-tempered person must pay the penalty. If you rescue them, you will have to do it again. It's a habit. Some people kind of use their anger so that people just kind of steer clear of them or walk on eggshells around them, or they tend to get their way. You better give them what they want, because if you don't, things aren't going to go well around here. See? And here's the thing about anger. Anger has more than one extreme. Most of our thoughts about anger have to do with the person who's really loud and using violent language and maybe even throwing some stuff around the room, acting out very strongly. And that is one extreme. We can explode in anger. We can give full vent to our fury. We can say, almost without thinking, stuff comes out of our mouths, and our volume can become deafening, and our words can become soul-shredding. Like, we can act that way. And when we do, it tends to tear things down and break things apart. And here's the funny thing about it, is that people who even habitually act out in their anger, they would prefer they don't do that. They don't like how it makes them feel after the fact. They don't want to be that kind of person. They're often ashamed of their behavior. And they'll ask for forgiveness. And they'll make promises that it won't happen again, but it keeps happening. And they can see the effect that it's having on their marriage. They can see the effect that it's having on their relationship with their children or with their employer or with their employees. My dad used to work for someone, and he was known just to go off all the time. And my dad told him one day, he said, if you keep doing this, you're going to get an ulcer. And this person responded to my father and said, I don't get ulcers. I give them. That's not good. But there's another extreme, and we don't think as much about this, and this is when we, instead of explode, we erode. We deny our feelings and we stuff them down. And there are things that are issues that deserve attention, but we ignore them because that's how we respond in anger. And here's the thing that you need to know about people who stuff their feelings down is they usually feel superior to people who explode. Because they didn't do that. They're still acting out of an anger. They're denying truth about themselves. They're denying issues that are going on. They keep stuffing this down. And when they look at somebody who did explode, they feel a little bit better than them. The problem is that when you stuff this anger down, it creates a toxic waste dump in our soul. And it can lead to a whole bunch of things like cynicism and depression and hopelessness. These are all the byproducts that just seep to the surface of our life as a result of just constantly stuffing all of this down. And when it even takes away their ability to be honest. If you ask them what's wrong, they will tell you. Nothing is wrong. And here's what you need to know. Buried anger is still anger. It still is. If you want to know what the power of erosion is, just look at the Grand Canyon. That'll give you some idea. So the Bible surprises us when it addresses the issue of anger because it seems to indicate that anger is neither good nor bad. It's, in fact, the Bible almost treats it like a currency. You can use your money for good things and you can use your money for bad things, but it's not the money itself that is the problem, and it's not the anger itself that is our problem. It's what we do with our anger that determines how effective we're going to be. And so if we want to learn how to manage our anger in God-honoring ways, then Scripture is really our only source of information to help us with this. And what we discover, and this surprises us, is that God gets angry. And so I know some of you are going, nope, I'm not surprised at all. I believed it my whole life. God gets angry. But this is why this is important. God gets angry because he loves. Anger reveals that something we love is being threatened. So what is that? If you see someone you love being hurt, how do you feel about that? If you see someone you love being taken advantage of, how do you feel about that? If you see a child that is suffering, how do you feel about that? Like, you'll have some emotions. In our world, we are told that the opposite of love is hate. That's actually not true. The opposite of love is apathy. When you just don't care what happens to anybody anymore. When you love someone, you will care. And God loves us, so there are things that will anger him, but God handles anger differently than we do. And this is really important for us to get a grasp of. God doesn't explode. How many are really glad about that? Because if we get a God explosion, I don't think any of us are going to fare very well in that. Now, what does it tell us? It tells us that God is slow to anger. He doesn't deny his anger. He doesn't vent his rage in anger. He is slow to anger. And if we are going to redeem situations in our life, rather than going to the extremes of blowing up or eroding and stuffing things down, we're going to have to find a different path forward. We have to learn how to be deliberate and intentional in the steps that we take. So, our tone matters. Our language matters. Our attitude matters. Sometimes we have to prep ourselves before we're able to have a conversation. It takes a little more time. Our actions have to be moderated. One time there was a person in the church and they had engaged in some really unhealthy behavior. And so the church council and myself met with them. And in case you're wondering, you don't know who this person is. No one who's on council was in the room at that point. And the person is no longer part of our church family. So for all of you Sherlock Holmes out there, good luck with this, okay? And so one council member asked the person a question, didn't make an accusation, just asked the person a question. And in that moment, that person went up to that council member and slapped them across the face. And we all went, and then we beat the snot out of him. No, we didn't. Why? Because if we explode, evil wins. You can't defeat evil by becoming evil. And this is a great wave of a concept that's just flowing through our world, but it's not new. It's always been the way people think, that when evil exercises options, the only way you can win over that is to become the thing that can destroy it, which is evil itself. And so when we act in evil ways, evil wins. That's what's true. But if we erode, if we, instead of just flashing out our fury, if we erode, evil wins then too, because the things that need to be attended to, the issues that need to be addressed, the steps that need to be taken, the words that need to be spoken, just goes into silence. And all it takes for evil to survive and thrive is for there to be silence. No one will call attention to what is wrong or what could be better. And so God shows us a different path. He shows us a way where evil doesn't win. He refuses to become evil, to eliminate evil. He refuses also to turn away from evil. Because if he does nothing, evil wins. God is so motivated by love that he will not misuse his anger, but he also will not ignore it. So how does he do this? Well, there's some ways to manage our anger. Number one, admit when you're angry. Admit when you're angry. I hate admitting when I'm angry because I have this internal thing that tells me if I'm angry, I must be sinning. And the Bible says, oddly enough, in your anger, do not sin. It does not say if you're angry, you are sinning. So admit it. Secondly, we must identify why we are angry. What is it that we love that's being threatened? What is it that we love that's being threatened? Anybody here ever been behind a car that is going unreasonably slow? It's happened to me. And have you ever gotten angry about that? Now, I don't make any gestures. I don't run them off the road. I don't do any of that stuff. But I will have a conversation in the car with if it's just me. And I'm like, I'll make recommendations that would benefit me a lot. And what do I love? If I am in the car and now I'm going to be late because of that person, I love my time, I love my sense of efficiency, I love my reputation of being places on time. You know what I don't love? I don't love that person right then. And that's the problem. That's why we have to identify why we're angry. And we can't do that if we're in denial about it. So why am I angry? What that I love is being threatened right now? And is that a worthwhile reason? If we've not identified what we love, we're not ready to speak to the issue yet. We can speak the truth without retreating or retaliating, but we got to sort that out. The third thing is that we cannot retreat. We cannot retaliate. I'm going to ask the worship team to come up. We cannot retreat. We cannot retaliate. Here's the problem. I think if you're ever facing an angry person, it's hard to withstand the fury that they can put up. To stand there and say, I'm not going away, just because that would make it easier for you, and I'm not going to give you a reason to justify your behavior. That's hard. It's also sometimes hard, and some Christians have been taught that this isn't correct. But let's say you're in a situation where this person might do harm to you because of their anger. And some people have been taught under the guise of Scripture that you're not supposed to say anything to them, or if they harm you, you're not supposed to do anything about it, that somehow that's a lack of forgiveness. That has nothing to do with forgiveness. A biblical response would say, listen, I don't have authority over you right now, and I can't control you right now, but if you continue in this vein, I can bring people who do have authority into the room. I mean, sometimes that's just calling the police. And if we're unwilling to do that, evil can triumph. A lot of damage can be done. So, well, Pastor, that sounds not a lot like Scripture. Well, think about it. It's what God did for us. He was angry at what humans were doing to each other. We were made in His image and His likeness, and He saw what humans were doing to each other. And it was not just a passive thing. It brought great emotion to Him. But He refused to vent such fury that it would destroy us all. And He refused to ignore it. So what was He? He was slow to anger. He was slow to anger. Can everybody just say that with me? He was slow to anger. And in that slowness, He sends His Son. And Jesus tells us the truth. He tells us the truth about God's love, which really irritated and annoyed some religious people. And He told us the truth about our sins, which really irritated and annoyed people who are struggling with things, and He told us the truth about the impact of our ways on other people, and it made them angry. And those people that He made angry didn't identify what they loved. If they had, they would have been embarrassed by it. It was their control, it was their reputation. And they didn't look at any of that. So they bound Jesus, and they beat Jesus, and they killed Jesus. And while this is happening, what does Jesus say? Father, forgive them. In that moment, Jesus is revealing who He loves. That's why forgiveness was an option. In Nehemiah 9:17, it says, they refused to listen. They failed to remember the miracles You performed among them. They became stiff-necked, and in their rebellion appointed a leader in order to return to their slavery. But You are a forgiving God, gracious, compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love. Therefore, You did not desert them. Is there anybody in the room that is grateful that God is slow to anger and refuses to desert us? Anybody else? Is that not a good thing? So how will you deal with anger? You already have a pattern. Is it biblical? Heavenly Father, this is a hard conversation for us because this is an emotion that often makes us embarrassed when we talk about it, and we don't like to think about it. Would you help us learn from you? Would you help us learn from you how to be slow to anger? Will you help us shake off any apathy that we have because we actually do love and care for others? Will you help us how to pray for what to do next? In Jesus' name, amen. Let's all stand together.